Welcome to Education Today. I'm your host, Kitty Kelly Epstein, and you are listening to KPFA 94.1 FM and streaming online at www.kpfa.org. Our special guest today is one of the most experienced organizers in the Bay Area. When people hear, which they often have on this show, about the strike that won ethnic studies, really for the whole country, they know a little bit about the fact that it was big, it was militant, there were a lot of police, a lot of people got arrested, and it was successful. Those are things that are important to know. But the one thing that doesn't get discussed so much is, how did it happen to happen at that particular school? Because San Francisco State is not a famous school around the country. Was it just an accident, just some happy event that a whole lot of people on the campus decided to get together and start protesting? Or was there something else involved in it? Something that we might want to pay attention to today, which is making a long-term strategic plan. And that's something we discuss less about that particular event. Our guest today is one of the main people who did that long-term strategic planning. He was involved in the Southern Civil Rights Movement. He was part of the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee. He was arrested. Then he went to San Francisco State and did these remarkable things we're going to talk about. And after that, he got a couple of degrees and served as both a faculty member and an administrator at several colleges. Jimmy Garrett, welcome to Education Today.
Good afternoon, Kitty. It's good to be here.
We're so happy to have you, and I think organizers of today, we get a little frustrated, worried, maybe a little pessimistic sometimes. So I think hearing about your planning can do us all a lot of good. So can you start out by just telling us what it was that landed you at San Francisco State and what kind of planning you and your student colleagues were involved in? And I should tell our guests, which I forgot to say, that one of the things people may not know is that at the point when Jimmy and his friends were organizing there, there were 4% Black students and there was no Black student union anywhere in the country. So things have changed quite a bit. Can you tell us about what you did?
Well, yeah, let's go two ways. One is that you had said, why would it happen in San Francisco State? And most of the people I know knew at that time would agree with you. We have to go back to 1960. When students and workers from the International Longshore Workers Union and people who were local to San Francisco participated in demonstrations against the House Un-American Activities Committee hearings that were held in 1960. Most of the people involved in those demonstrations were learning or trying to make breakthroughs to open up space for thinking, that thinking was really controlled, centralized during the period of, we call it Mark McCarthyism, where you had to conform very solidly to everything that was to the basic notes and ideas of the ruling ideas of the time. Conformity was the thing. That's one set of circumstances that led students, after those demonstrations, they moved back into their work and also into study. So some of them went into University of California at Berkeley, and out of that came the Berkeley movement, which was well-known globally. And the other was a set of mainly white students and some Asian students who set up an organization on campus to run for office, pushing liberal ideas, meaning integrations, working in communities, tutorial programs. That's how they manifested their, in concrete terms, their own work. At the other end of that was the end that I was involved with, and that was movement in the of civil rights movement. I had gotten involved with civil rights movement going back to 1960. I was involved in sit-ins in my hometown, Dallas, Texas. I'd gone down for summer relief in the Deep South from Los Angeles to where my family had moved and got involved in the movement there. Came back, and I was hooked in the movement. I got involved with CORE, Congress of Racial Equality, NAACP Youth Leagues, and various other groupings, and Freedom Rides, and kind of the whole stick. So I also worked in Mississippi with SNCC, and coming out of that, I was chosen to run the L.A. SNCC office, fundraising office, in 1964. I think I was 19 years old. My job was to raise $2 or $3 million to support SNCC. And I mean, it was really $175,000, but that was big money. I mean, $175,000 was big money. So
For a 19-year-old, that sounds like a very large project, even today.
Oh, yeah. I mean, Jim Foreman and Ruby Doris Robinson said, Jimmy, we want you to do this. We're going to support you, but we want you to... The thing about the movement that was very good for me and moves forward is that the people who I was connected with movement never told me that I couldn't do. They always encouraged me. And they never said you can't do. They never said you're incapable of doing this. I'm really out of the projects in both in Dallas and L.A. So, I mean, that's where I came from. I came from working class, working people. But so the expectations weren't high at the kind of corporate level, but they were very high in the movement. In any case, while I was involved with the movement in the South, I was taught that the basic unit of organizing in the South, the people who did most of the work, especially in SNCC, were people who came off the Southern Black campus. They call historically Black colleges and universities. We used to call them colored colleges and Negro colleges. But that's where everybody came. Almost everybody, 80% of SNCC came from, were Black students out of that set. And so you saw that was that concentration of students. Their organizational skills really came through the church or off that campus. So I picked that up, and then I saw, because I was my part of my job was to travel around to the various campuses in Southern California in 1964-65, is that there was an increasing number of Black students who were matriculating to predominantly white college campuses in California. And what I did was, in my meetings with people with SNCC, we would share ideas, and probably that whole year, that from the fall of 64 until the uprising in L.A. in August of 65, there was always this sharing, and we shared these ideas. And basically what happened was that I came to consolidate one of many ideas that were floating around SNCC about what would happen if you go onto a predominantly white college campus and then work with the existing Black community and the liberal community, white liberal community on that campus, and then recruit Black people from the surrounding community onto the campus and use the campus as a base to train young people to contribute for the rest of their lives doing what you had decided to do, that is to serve the Black community and to ameliorate their situation. That was my ideal. And I began to work with a number of people. I talked to Bob Moses, who was the icon at that time, and Charlie Cobb, who was one of the people who was instrumental in designing the freedom schools in the Mississippi Freedom Schools, and others, and ultimately began that work. I mean, I began the work of planning to see if that model, if we could build a model of a black organization on a campus that would encompass everybody who identified as being black or who identified with the struggle of black people on a campus. So that's basically the first part of that work. The second part of the work came when I came together with the woman who became my work partner for 10 years. Her name was Pamela Gashera. I met her in jail in Jackson, Mississippi. She's a woman who was born in Japanese in the concentration camp for Japanese citizens. They call them relocation camps. She was born in one of those camps. Very, very bitter about her experiences or feelings by whites. She was Japanese American, but she was the coldest black nationalist in and around the SNCC. So, she lived in the Bay Area. She was a first year student at UC Berkeley, and she had come down for the summer with white students and had gotten arrested in the South. In any case, we began the planning process trying to break out which school we were going to go to. There were two schools out there. One was Michigan State because they had East Lansing, which was a black community attached to that university, Michigan State, or San Francisco State. We ended up choosing San Francisco State because it was in California and Pam knew the neighborhood, and I had contacts with people in San Francisco from the SNCC Friends of SNCC office, but there were also people I had been involved with in the civil rights movement over time who I could make connections with. So from, I would say, from September, late September, October, until until January of 1966, when the semester, the spring semester began at San Francisco State. We did background studies on the history of San Francisco, on black communities in the Bay Area. Pam and me, we first began our studies in L.A., and then we moved up to San Francisco and engaged in long-term study. We needed to know every community from Hunters Point, Bayview, to Fillmore, to wherever there were clusters of blacks or clusters of what we call third world people at that time. We began to try to understand those communities. We found that there was a really rich community of a rich cultural and politically conscious community in the Bay Area. And the question was, how can we connect with those communities? The Afro-American Association, the Nation of Islam, a number of black nationalists, clusters of black nationalists. There were people who were from the Revolutionary Action Movement. On the campus itself, there were black sororities and fraternities, and there was a cluster of probably half a dozen African dance groups. There was a sister by the name of Dolores Caillou who was taking some lead in training all these people in African dance. So we had this kind of bits and pieces of culture consciousness. So it wasn't like zero. It was a large cluster, but the notion of the organizer is to prepare, do a great deal of preparation and study of the community, go into the community and make contacts with everybody you can in those communities, and then settle in for the long term of working with, trying to pull all these factors, all these sectors together. In this case, around an intentional program to build a black organization on a predominantly white college campus. So I went to San Francisco State, that is me and my work partners, although Pam never did become a student. She really stayed in the background to do the study. That was her choice. That was her decision to do the. She said you always needed to have a chore in life. If you're going to have a mouth, say tongue. Somebody has to do the instrumental work. And if you're going to make the sauce to use on spaghetti, you better have some foundation. Somebody's always doing the prep work, and you can filter backwards. So that was what, that's her choice. Her choice was to not go forward. She thought that she would not be accepted within the black community, although later on we learned that that wasn't the case. But that was our understanding at the time. We didn't want to take the chance. So I entered the campus in January. The intent was very simple. As an insurgency, going to campus to build an organization. The organization, there was all these bits and pieces or groups of people on the campus. So and there was also the liberal students who had set up an experimental college. They were involved in the things that I mentioned very early. The whites were running tutorial programs, almost all whites tutoring black, Asian, Latino kids, almost all white women, actually. They had a community involvement program, which was an attempt to use various types of organizing to make contacts with people in the community. That was their organizing effort. So they had all these various kinds of programs that now became normal on liberal college, on college campuses, as an expression of outreach. And we moved to seize those. We began to work with the blacks on the campus. The first group of people that I came to work with were three sisters, three black women, Joanne Mitchell, Patricia Rivera, and Vanetta McGee. Vanetta McGee went on to become a top movie actress. But at the time, these were all recent graduates from a Catholic high school, and they had engaged in leadership training on Catholic high schools, had come to the campus and united with Mariana Waddy in an organization called the Negro Students Association. And that was kind of a base for open-ended. It was a safe place for black students to go to engage in current issues, discussions about black art and culture, et cetera. It was those three women who I worked with initially on the campus. We spent about 6 weeks, again, identifying every community, every sector, every clique on the campus. And then we began to try to sew those together to unite under the banner of the Negro Students Association. Those three women are really the people that were the glue that pulled everything together on the campus. They agreed with the intention that me and Pam raised about building a black student union. But the black student union, which was the name of the black student union, came from Patricia Rivera, because the union would mean everybody on the campus who identified with the black students on the campus was a member of the union. You didn't have to pay tithing. You didn't have to pay membership. If you saw yourself as a member, you were a member. And everybody on the campus who was a member of the black student union saw anybody who identified themselves as being black on the campus as being a member. So that meant that it encompassed everyone. And it included, in the final analysis, people from Latin and South America. It included Asians. It included a number of people. But, of course, the broad mass were black students. And the leadership, it was black, bred, led, and dominated. And the goal was to begin to train, to recruit numbers of students onto the campus. Over a period of 2.5 years, we went from a collection of about 150 students on the campus when I got to the campus in spring of 1966. When I finally was about to be sentenced to prison in May, late May of 1968, We had nearly 1,200 non-white students on the campus. About 850, about between 800 and 900 of those were black students. So we had gone from 150 to over 800 students in 2.5 years. We had brought on the campus transfers, first-year students, and we brought them from Hunters Point, we brought them from Bayview, we brought them from low middle class, we brought them from the street hustlers and prostitutes to people who were deeply involved in the church. Two of the leaders of the Black Student Union came out of the Church of God in Christ. That's George Murray, who became the Minister of Education for the Black Panther Party. And Benny Stewart.
And I want to remind our listeners that first that you are listening to Education Today. We're talking with Jimmy Garrett, who was one of the first leaders at San Francisco State, called by many people a visionary leader, and he's talking about that whole period. And I also want to remind people that at the period of time that he's talking about, there was no such thing as a Black Student Union anywhere else. No. Jimmy, am I correct? The first Black Student Union ever organized was the one that was organized at San Francisco State, because people weren't calling themselves, everybody wasn't calling themselves Black. In fact,
that's right.
There was a song that helped people. So people, it was the Negro Student Associate. Yeah. I'm Black and I'm Proud. I think that probably contributed to getting the solidification of the name of the organization. But it's important for people to realize that none of these things can be taken for granted historically. They all had to be created in the kind of ways that Jimmy's describing. Go ahead.
Yeah, you have to build that. There were Black students on the campus who ultimately became leaders of the Black Student Union, who when you came on the campus, if you call them Black, you might get a fight. Because that was called a negative. That was called viewed as being a negative. But James Brown and the cultural dynamic that surrounded what was going on was important. I think we need to go back and state that Abdul Karim, who was one of the leading forces among the what we call Black nationalist forces on the campus, was teaching a class in Black nationalism through the experimental college, which had been set up by white students, Jim and Cynthia Nixon, and they had set up this piece. I was teaching a class on Fanon and on community organizing. And when we set up the Black Student Union, probably the three things that we started with was to set up what we used to call political education courses. Everybody had to be involved in education. Everybody had to read. So we had to have, so reading and study and discussion was huge. It was very important because it gave everybody a common grounding so that you didn't have the kind of pyramidal middle leadership. You could call everybody together to discuss certain issues and questions. Because everybody was given the task of everybody reading, not one person reading and then teaching everybody else. We didn't believe that one person had the bank of knowledge. We felt that everyone was capable of reading. Well, some people didn't have a high level of literacy, so that meant that we had to bring in graduate students to tutor students on the tutor Black students in reading. And sometimes writing, so that they could join in the process. And people really wanted to read, and they really want because they wanted to be a part of this dynamic. They felt an ownership to the Black Student Union that was just being formed. And a number of the Black nationalists in the community said, don't do anything with white folks because you're just going to be integrated and it's just about sleeping with white women. Well, our intention was to take over every piece of low-hanging fruit that we could. So the Black Student Union didn't integrate, and we didn't throw anybody out of anything. We had George Murray out of the Church of God in Christ and Joanne Mitchell take over the tutorial program. Marianna Waddy, who was the first chair of the Black Student Union, I succeeded her, and then Benny Stewart succeeded me. Marianna Waddy went over to the Experimental College and immediately demanded half of the Associated Students funds to run what became the Black Arts and Culture series. It's out of that foundation.
So Jimmy, hang on one second. So we only have a couple minutes left, and okay, the whole history is I mean, I'm learning a lot, and I thought I knew all of this already. So I'm learning a lot. I'm sure our listeners are too. But in the last minute or two that we have, I wonder if a lot of the lessons from this for the current period are obvious, okay, from what you're saying.
That's what I want.
Is there anything particular that you want to say as advice to organizers now, which you are still an organizer yourself, but is there any immediate advice about things people aren't doing that they should start doing in the last minute or two that we have?
Basically, I think that people are doing things, but I think you have to invite me back to talk about the future, because we have a very, very dangerous process that's going on now, because the movement itself, the global movement for change, has lapsed, and the dominant force in the world right now is authoritarianism. In this country, that's neo-Nazism with DeSantis and Trump and others. So that the real work is the preparation and study on the history of this authoritarianism, white nationalism, white supremacy, white Christian nationalism. People have to study on it. They can't just start talking about it and reacting to it. You need to go all the way back to the 1930s in this country, and all the way back to the post-war period, 1950s in this country, and look at neo-Nazism around the world. And those are the things. That preparation, that struggle is going to be the next generation of struggle. We are not winning, so we are in a defensive posture now. We were in an offensive posture at some points in the 60s. We're in a more defensive posture. We shouldn't act like we're winning. We've got to prepare for the next level of struggle of defense, defense against the United States Supreme Court, defense against neoliberalism, and defense against neo-fascism, neo-Nazism. That work requires study. It requires debate among ourselves. It requires building small groups of people through the internet or whatever, however we can, flash mobs of study, flash mobs of debate, flash mobs of participation in fighting back against this new this global dynamic of authoritarianism. You got to be a part of that, but you've got to be prepared, not simply in reaction to it, but preparation requires study, work, debate, working through various factors of it. That would be my way of looking at it. Please understand.
Thank you.
We are not winning, and so we have to work.
Yeah, thank you, and I it sounds right to me. I really appreciate you being with us. I hope we will be able to invite you back, because I think that additional conversation is something we really need. You've been listening to Education Today. We've been talking with Jimmy Garrett, who is one of the most important organizers in the Bay Area. We're here every Wednesday at 2:30 in the afternoon Pacific time. Thank you to our engineer, Kirsten Thomas, and my co-host, Jaron Epstein, and we'll see you again next week. Bye-bye.
KPFA's Local Station Board election is here, and we invite you to participate. In order to vote and run as a candidate, you must be a current member by making a minimum donation of $25 between July 1st, 2022 and June 30th, 2023. If your membership has lapsed, go to kpfa.org/donate to become a member today. Make sure to give your email at the time of renewal, as this is where you will receive your e-ballot. Visit elections.pacifica.org for the voter guide, candidate nomination package, and nominator registration. Candidate nomination packets must be completed by June 30th. Contact the election supervisor by emailing nes@pacifica.org or leaving a voicemail on 213-635-9363. It's 94.1 KPFA, 89.3 KPFB in Berkeley, 88.1 KFCF in Fresno, 97.5 K248BR in Santa Cruz, and online at kpfa.org.